Now we'll up the ante and generate electromagnetic waves in two dimensions. We'll generate E fields aligned with the Z axis that can vary in the X and Y directions. So the X and Y components of the E field are zero. Since the X and Y components are zero, their partial derivatives are also zero, as we see on the second line, and we can substitute these values into Maxwell's third equation for the 3D model to get Maxwell's third equation for the 2D model. And that's what we'll do. So we have, for the 2D model, the partial derivative of E sub Z with respect to Y equals minus the time derivative of B sub X, and minus the partial derivative of E sub Z with respect to X equals minus the time derivative of B sub Y. And finally, 0 equals the time derivative of B sub Z, so B sub Z is constant, and we'll assume that it's 0. By assumption, the E field only has a Z component, so the D field only has a Z component. And from the previous slide, the Z component of the B field is 0, and hence its derivatives are 0. And also we assume that the wave is traveling in a non-conducting medium, so the J field is identically 0. Making these substitutions into Maxwell's fourth equation for the 3D model gives Maxwell's fourth equation for the 2D model, which is minus the partial derivative of B sub Y with respect to Z equals 0, which doesn't figure into the 2D model. The partial derivative of B sub X with respect to Z equals 0, which also doesn't figure into the model. And finally, the partial derivative of B sub Y with respect to X minus the partial derivative of B sub X with respect to Y equals mu times the time derivative of D sub Z. And this equation is part of the 2D model. Summarizing, for our 2D model, we have, in component form, Maxwell's third equation, the partial derivative of E sub Z with respect to X equals the time derivative of B sub Y, and the partial derivative of E sub Z with respect to Y equals the time derivative of B sub X. And Maxwell's fourth equation, the partial derivative of B sub Y with respect to X minus the partial derivative of B sub X with respect to Y equals mu times the time derivative of D sub Z. As per convention, we rewrite the model in terms of the E and H fields, and we make the FDM substitutions, resulting in the equation shown at the bottom of the page. Then we rewrite the equations using the Courant number and eta sub zero, the impedance of free space, and compress these constants into two constants, CH and CE, with the resulting computational equations shown. This is the code for the main loop of our out-of-the-box FDM simulation. Note that we have to save the E fields and H fields at time Tn and time Tn minus 1 before computing their values at time Tn plus 1. We use the computational equations to compute the interior values for the H and E fields, and that code is shown, and then we apply the Neumann boundary conditions, and we're done. Now we need to generate an EM wave, and instead of using our usual Gaussian pulse, we'll use a Ricker wavelet, which is frequently used in EM simulations because its frequency content can be controlled, and it has a zero DC component. The diagram shows the shape of a Ricker wavelet in the inset, and it looks like a Mexican hat. The diagram also shows the frequency content of a pulse. There is a built-in MATLAB function called MexiHat to generate Ricker wavelets, but we'll use the code shown here in case it's not part of your system. We need boundary conditions. We'll specify passive Neumann boundary conditions on the top and bottom boundaries. Ideally, we would like to have absorbing boundaries, but specifying an absorbing boundary for 2 and 3D simulations is a complicated matter. We will put a perfect electric conductor on the right boundary. In the second and third simulation, we'll put a barrier plate in the path of the wave to see what happens when a wave hits a barrier with holes in it. The barrier will be implemented by a perfect electric conductor that is 2 grid points wide. It needs to be 2 grid points wide for it to be able to reflect waves from either side. Finally, we'll generate the input wave by generating 1D Ricker wavelets propagating to the right at each point on the left boundary, creating a 2D plane wave. The first simulation shows a plane wave traveling to the right and hitting the right boundary and being reflected back. The second simulation is similar to the first, but the wave hits a barrier in the center of the field. The barrier reflects part of the wave back, and the wave passes by the sides of the barrier. The third simulation shows the wave hitting a barrier with 2 holes. The assignment is to reproduce the results in the vid.